Let's take a quick look at the very short Chapter 13, Modern Understanding of Inheritance. Section 1 covers chromosomal theory and genetic linkage, while Section 2 covers the chromosomal basics of inherited disease. The chromosomal theory of inheritance was built with the help of these two men, Boveri's on the left and Sutton is on the right. Boveri studied sea urchin development and realized the importance of condensed chromosomes, while Sutton was able to correctly observe the process of meiosis. Both men were working in 1902, but just in separate places. There were five pieces of supporting evidence for their theory. One was that homologous chromosomes migrate independently. Another was that the sorting of those chromosomes appeared to happen at random. All gametes were 1N, and the gametes of male and females have the same chromosomes and the same chromosome numbers. Finally, chromosomes in the offspring, chromosome numbers that is, match the chromosome numbers in the parents. The only potential issue that they saw was that there were so many traits and so few chromosomes. They didn't yet know that each chromosome could potentially carry thousands of genetic variations and genes. Mendel's work suggested that traits are independently inherited of one another. Morgan, Thomas Morgan, a man who worked in a fly lab, identified a one-to-one correspondence with some segregating traits and the way that they tracked on the X chromosome. He realized that random segregation was the physical basis for Gregor Mendel's model. However, there's an existence of something called linked genes, and linked genes could disrupt Mendel's predicted outcomes. Linked genes are tied to the fact that each chromosome can carry many, many genes sitting very closely all in a row. This allows us to have many more traits than we do individual chromosomes. However, some great observations by researchers in Morgan's laboratory suggest that alleles are positioned on the same chromosome and they don't always have to be inherited together. During meiosis, linked genes somehow become unlinked. The inheritance patterns of linked and unlinked genes are shown over the next couple of slides. In this image, you see two genes located on different chromosomes, so independent assortment can occur in meiosis. The offspring, therefore, have an equal chance of being the parental phenotype, so inheriting exactly what their parents had, or the non-parental type, which means that they inherit a different combination than that of their parents. Therefore, the offspring are a mix of the two parents rather than an identical copy. In B, off to the left, you see that two genes can be very close together on the same chromosome, so there's no crossing over occurring between them. The genes are therefore always inherited together, and all of the offspring look like the parental type. In situation C, off to the right, there are two genes that are very far apart on a chromosome, so crossing over commonly occurs during every single meiotic event. The recombination frequency will be the same as if the genes were on separate chromosomes. These genes commonly become unlinked. The actual recombination frequency of fly length and body color, that's what Thomas Morgan was observing, was about 17%. So he realized that a crossover frequency between 0% and 50% indicates that genes are on the same chromosome, and that crossover occurs just some of the time. He wasn't entirely sure what to do with this information until a very helpful student named Alfred pulled an all-nighter and came up with the very first chromosome map. He used recombination rates to infer the distances of genes on a single chromosome. In honor of his teacher, he created his very own values and referred to them as centimorgans. Recombination frequencies are often discussed in terms of percentages. There are some assumptions that Alfred stuck with. He figured that genes exist in a particular order, and unless something is wrong, they should always be in the same order on every chromosome, and that they should all be able to move. He correlated a 0.01% chance of recombination as being one centimorgan. He realized that some genes are perfectly linked, and they had a 0% chance of being separated. Other genes, however, he coined as being perfectly unlinked. They were far enough apart that 50% of the time they were going to be separated in meiotic events. When technology arose, Mendel's traits were studied closely, and the 7 random traits that he chose could all be considered perfectly unlinked. He was lucky in his choices, as his experiments would not have worked out nearly as well or as cleanly if he didn't pick perfectly unlinked traits. This concept of genetic maps, linkage frequencies, allowed us to figure out what genes went where and on what chromosome. This is a karyotype of a female human. Notice that the homologous chromosomes are the same size and that they have centromeric positions and very specific banding patterns. A human male would have an XY chromosome as that very last pair instead of the XX pair that's currently shown. Autosomal chromosomes are numbered from 1 to 22, and they're ranked in descending order by height, with the exception of 21 and 22. It wasn't until advanced technology allowed us to measure these perfectly that we realized 21 is actually a tiny bit shorter. They never changed its order because trisomy 21, or Down syndrome, was so common in the literature it would be too much of a headache to go back and update everything and refer to Down syndrome as trisomy 22. When we look at our chromosomes, we can label a few different things. We can discuss the centromeric position, the length of the chromosome, but we even have names for the individual arms of the X's. The short arm is known as the P arm, P just standing for petite, and the lower portion is known as the Q. So you can quite literally mind your P's and Q's, although some scientists say that that was just a joke, that the long arm was called the Q arm simply because it was the next letter in the alphabet. Non-disjunction errors can occur when homologous chromosomes, or sister chromatids, fail to separate at any point during meiosis, and this results in an abnormal chromosome number. Non-disjunction may occur during meiosis 1 or meiosis 2. Aneuploidy changes are changes in chromosome numbers. Healthy individuals are said to be euploid, or true ploidy. You can either have a monosomy, where you're missing an entire chromosome, or a trisomy, where you have an entire extra chromosome. Trisomies 8, 9, 13, 18, 21, and 22 are all known to exist in surviving humans. The incidence of having a child with a trisomy or a monosomy increases dramatically with maternal age. While we can treat the health issues that occur because of these errors in meiotic division, we don't yet have a way to avoid them. Genes produce products like proteins, and having too much of a particular product can be extremely dangerous. This increase in material is known as an extra gene dose. The higher the dose, the larger and more dangerous the potential problem. Polyploidy is when you have an entire extra set of chromosomes, and it's far more common in plants because they don't have the deleterious effects of extra gene dosages like animals do. There are some animals that can survive polyploidy, though. Flatworms, crustaceans, amphibians, fish, and lizards are all known to handle polyploidy well enough to survive, at least. As with many polyploid plants, this triploid orange daylily is particularly large and robust, and it grows flowers with triple the number of petals as its diploid counterparts. So there are some effects of being polyploid, but they don't tend to be deleterious when it comes to plant material, especially those flowering plants. X inactivation helps to combat extra gene dosages. The extra X in a female individual can be compacted down into something called a bar body. Bar bodies keep any genes from being overexpressed by the existence of 2 identical X chromosomes. Having alternate numbers of sex chromosomes can change physical characteristics and fertility in those that carry them, but they don't tend to be fatal because there aren't as many gene products located on those particular chromosomes. In some instances, there are simply duplications and deletions within the chromosomes themselves. A chromosomal segment as a whole can be duplicated or lost. This often produces offspring that survive but exhibit various mental and physical abnormalities. Duplicated chromosomal segments can actually fuse to an existing chromosome, or they may just be freely floating around the nucleus with the potential to be expressed. Croup de chat, which is French for cry of the cat, is a syndrome associated with nervous system abnormalities and very identifiable physical features that result from the deletion of most of the 5p, the small arm, of chromosome number 5. Individuals with this genotype emit a very characteristic high-pitched cry on which the disorder's name is based. Chromosomal structural arrangements can happen. With inversions, a portion of the chromosome is actually detached, rotated 180 degrees, and then reinserted back into the original chromosome. Pericentric inversions include the centromere, while paracentric inversions do not. A pericentric inversion can change the relative lengths of the chromosomes, while the paracentric version doesn't. These aren't terribly dangerous unless a break occurs where the rotation is in the middle of a gene. If it doesn't, usually these effects aren't too wide-ranging. When one chromosome undergoes an inversion, though, and the other doesn't, the chromosome must form an inverted loop to retain that nice point-to-point interaction during synapsis when we're making new gametes. This inversion pairing is essential to maintain gene alignment during meiosis and allow for correct recombination. This is when those inversions can become dangerous. The final potential chromosome error discussed in this chapter are reciprocal translocations. A reciprocal translocation occurs when a segment of DNA is transferred from one chromosome to another non-homologous chromosome. There are some very famous reciprocal translocations. One is known to cause some very specific forms of cancer, while another is seen in schizophrenia patients. This suggests that to cure some of these diseases, like schizophrenia, we would actually have to do gene editing, and there are a lot of scientists that are looking at topics such as these right now. Thus ends that particular chapter. Go ahead and read it. It's very, very short. Take your own notes on the text and see what information stands out to you. Then take a crack at your homework.